From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice. Here's your host.
Hello, and welcome to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Christopher Seymour from the University of Pittsburgh, and today I'll be joined by Dr. Ross Davenport from Queen Mary University of London Blizzard Institute, and Dr. Nicola Curry from Oxford University Hospitals NHS Foundation Trust. They're both joining me here to talk about early and empirical high-dose cryoprecipitate for hemorrhage after traumatic injury. Welcome.
Thank you. It's a great pleasure to be here.
So, Dr. Curry, Nikki, why don't you go ahead and tell us a little bit about yourself?
So, I am a hematologist, and in my day job, I work at the Hemophilia and Thrombosis Center. So, I look after patients who either bleed too much or who clot too much. So, that's my day job. And then my other half of my time is spent doing research in acquired bleeding. So, looking at the underlying clotting abnormalities and trying to understand it a little bit better in trauma patients particularly, but moving also into other settings as well.
Thanks. And Dr. Davenport, or Ross.
Thanks, Chris. It's a pleasure to be joining you today. I'm a trauma and vascular surgeon by training, and I work at the Royal London Major Trauma Centre, one of the busiest in Europe. The other half of my job is as an academic with a particular interest in trauma-induced coagulopathy at the Centre for Trauma Science, which is one of the leading institutes for trying to look at traumatic coagulopathy.
Great. Well, it's really exciting to have you both join today. Let's just start at the beginning. What is cryoprecipitate, and why are we looking at this in our injured patients?
So cryoprecipitate is a plasma product that comes from whole blood and is used principally to replace fibrinogen for patients as a transfusion therapy. It is made by fractionation and by controlled thawing and leads to the formation of a product that has a lot of high molecular weight proteins in it, which are fibrinogen, but also factor VIII, von Willebrand factor, fibronectin, alpha-2 antiplasmin. So it's a mix of almost hyper-concentrated plasma and is given principally to replace fibrinogen therapy. Where we got to in terms of trying to use cryoprecipitate for trauma-induced hemorrhage was that Ross and Professor Karen Brohey have led really the field in the UK alongside many other people across the world in the US and Europe, but have led the field in trying to understand what happens to the clotting system in patients who get severe injury. And one of the things that they found out, and I was working with them at the time, was that patients who bleed a lot have low fibrinogen levels. And so there was some work that was done that showed that patients who came into hospital after significant injury who were bleeding had low fibrinogen levels. We found that in association with those low fibrinogen levels, those patients had a high mortality rate both at 24 hours after hospital admission and at 28 days, and they had a high rate of bleeding. And so what we wanted to do using those data was to try to think about whether if we were to treat patients who had low fibrinogen levels, we could improve mortality outcomes and improve or reduce their risk of bleeding. So we looked at other studies, and we were able to not only demonstrate from our study, but from other studies that were published from the military setting particularly. So the MATTERS study and also a study from the US, they both demonstrated that in observational settings, if you have patients that are bleeding a lot and you give them fibrinogen replacement in some form or other, those patients did better. So we had multiple settings that showed from an observational standpoint, patients seemed to do better if they received fibrinogen replacement.
So, Nikki, if I might pause you there. So you've said the word observational a few times.
Yeah.
How was the evidence building in other trials of cryoprecipitate? Had there been smaller work before cryostat 2?
No, nothing. Now, what I haven't touched on is that fibrinogen replacement, there are different formats of how fibrinogen replacement can be given. Two standard methods. One is through cryoprecipitate, which is from whole blood and is a standard therapy for the UK and for the US and other areas in the world. But There's also a fibrinogen concentrate therapy that can be given and is more commonly given in Europe. So prior to Cryostat 1, which was our prelude, our feasibility study that we used prior to the study that we're really here to talk about, there hadn't been any randomized controlled trials looking at the delivery of cryoprecipitate at the time that we started that study.
Ross, take us through briefly Cryostat 1 and how that informed the questions we're looking at in Cryostat 2.
The observational data was very strong, and also the biological rationale that fibrinogen is the substrate for blood clots. And if you have a low fibrinogen, you can't make a good blood clot. And low fibrinogen associated with poor outcomes from bleeding and all-cause mortality. So it's sort of natural to then say between our two centres in Oxford and London is let's do a pilot study to see really, is it feasible to get a frozen product from the transfusion laboratory, high-dose fibrinogen into a bleeding patient in a sensible timeframe? And this small study, 50 patients across our centres, showed rather surprisingly a very strong mortality signal, 29% mortality in those patients that didn't receive early cryo and 10% mortality in those that did. So that really was the impetus to look at this further. The thing that was different across that one was that it was actually two pools of cryo, so equivalent to 4 grams of fibrinogen. And what we really believed was that the benefit was likely to be across the board and that you would need to give the intervention at a slightly higher dose, but early on to stop patients falling into very low levels of fibrinogen. And we know from that early pilot study that by the time you got to 8 units, you had extremely low levels of fibrinogen, about 0.5 grams per deciliter. So we're talking about profoundly low levels of fibrinogen. The rationale then building to Cryostat 2 was higher dose, empiric therapy, and to give it early as you possibly could.
All right. So those seem like big steps forward in terms of the trial design. Can you be a little bit more specific about the timing? We know these patients are coming in and perhaps they're hypotensive or bleeding, but what was the clinical moment that you were really searching for? Was this in the ambulance? Was it on arrival to the emergency department or the ICU? Describe the setting in which you were enrolling the patients and who you were really targeting the treatment for.
Cryoprecipitate features in most massive hemorrhage protocols, but it occurs typically after the second or third shock pack or transfusion pack. And we know that this is, generally speaking, across the board in the US and UK, something around 1 or 2 hours from the point that the massive hemorrhage protocol started being delivered. So it's actually not very quick, but it is certainly within that acute bleeding phase. The reason it's not very quick is that there are some logistical challenges to getting a frozen product from a transfusion laboratory, thawing it, portering it to the patient's bedside, checking it, and then giving it to the patient. So whilst we recognise it's important to give, the rationale for moving to empiric was to try to actually get that 1 or 2 hours down to something within an hour or 90 minutes. And what we know from Cryostat 1 is they are significant logistical challenges. So the timing for Cryostat 2 was to give this intervention within 90 minutes of arrival.
And the intervention itself was an open label design. And it sounds like you were very specific about the dose and then also that patients in the control arm could also receive cryo then if it was part of a protocol.
What we wanted to do is make this as pragmatic as possible. So standard of care features fibrinogen. It occurs late. We were not looking to test fibrinogen versus no fibrinogen. We know that fibrinogen is important. What we wanted to do was recognize the fact we were probably giving not enough and not giving it quick enough. So we were bringing all of that fibrinogen as close as we could to the point that the patient was arriving in hospital, accepting those logistical challenges.
May I add to that? From the Cryostat 1 data, when we used two pools of cryoprecipitate, we did take blood samples from those patients throughout their time scale that they were in and they were bleeding. And we were able to show that with two pools of cryoprecipitate, their fibrinogen levels bottomed out, if you like, at around 1.8 grams per litre, whereas data that have been accumulating from other settings really sort of suggested that we should be trying to keep the fibrinogen level above 2 grams. And so therefore, this led us to altering the intervention dose that we used for Cryostat-2. So the feasibility study gave us a lot of data to help us design our next study.
That sort of sets the stage then for thinking through your findings. To fill in a few gaps, it looks like 28-day all-cause mortality was the primary outcome. There was balanced randomization and a specific interest in patients who were already receiving a unit of blood as part of an MHP activation or massive hemorrhage protocol activation, or were hypotensive. So tell us a little bit about the primary findings.
It was a surprise, frankly, because we clearly thought there was going to be a difference between the two arms here. You know, taking all patients together, there was really no difference at all in the primary outcome, 26% versus 25%, which was a definite surprise to all of the authors on the study. Is it such a surprise now we've had time to digest this? And I think we would probably all agree, perhaps not, because there are reasons why empiric therapy may have reached the end of the road, particularly for bleeding patients, because we clearly didn't know by treating patients empirically how many of these patients actually had a low level of fibrinogen. And there is, from data that we now know, that probably only about 25% of patients on admission will have a low level of fibrinogen. However, going forward, those patients will clearly, if they're bleeding, may develop a fibrinogen level. And if you have trauma-induced coagulopathy, your fibrinogen levels below the threshold for replacement are probably up to about 75% of patients.
So I guess there's a lot to unpack with differential diagnosis of why the primary finding was neutral. But before I dig into that, I also saw that this was quite a large trial and had pretty detailed measurements of any safety concerns or thrombotic events. Nikki, can you just tell us a little bit about those findings?
It has been one of the largest transfusion trials that has been conducted. And we've started powering it to look for a 7% mortality difference, which meant that we needed just over 1,500 patients, so 1,568. But we ended up, because we got a few more dropouts than we estimated, we increased it to 1,600 and just got over that when we closed. So I think it is a powerful study because of the size of it, and it provides us with a huge amount of data, even for our subgroups of patients, because they are quite large. One of our main safety endpoints were to look at thrombotic events, both venous and arterial, because you always have to look at the benefit of something that you're giving, but then you have to look at the downsides of what you're giving. And we wanted to make sure that by giving extra fibrinogen, that we weren't going to increase the risk of thrombosis, because fibrinogen is obviously very important in the formation of clots. So we looked at any type of venous thrombotic disease and arterial disease in the general sense, in a practical, pragmatic way. So they needed to be symptomatic of the condition for us to be investigating it, reporting it. This is a study that if anyone tests you about it, everything is pretty much the same on the face of it. The VTE, the venous thrombotic events, were 7% in both arms, and the arterial thrombotic events were around 3% in both arms. So in many ways, you can say what we have also demonstrated is that cryoprecipitate does not increase thrombotic harm, which is a helpful and useful thing to understand on a practical setting.
Thank you for going into that detail. And you used the word everything was the same, but actually it may not have been in some of those subgroups that were pre-specified. So Ross, it's tantalizing to look at the type of injury that these patients had and whether there was a differential treatment effect. But take me through your thoughts about those subgroups.
We maybe have been naive in thinking that the physiology alone after trauma hemorrhage is the same, and therefore the treatment of a transfusion product would afford the same benefit or not to your patient groups. I think the most striking thing in these subgroup analyses here is the profound difference in the penetrating versus blunt trauma patients. There was a statistically significant signal for harm in patients who had penetrating trauma, by which if you received cryoprecipitate and you had sustained penetrating trauma, you did worse than the standard of care. And in the blunt patients, if you had received cryoprecipitate, there was, albeit not quite statistically significant, but a signal towards benefit if you received cryoprecipitate. So the complete opposite direction of effect here. Why might that be? I think, now this is hypothesis only, but when we looked at some other subgroups around timing, there was a U-shaped distribution related to mortality and time, where there appeared to be a sweet spot between 60 minutes and 90 minutes of if you received cryoprecipitate, you actually had improved outcome. Now, there are important caveats here when we talk about this, because the comparison for those time windows was not against the same in the standard of care, because we weren't comparing placebo. So we had to compare against the standard group. What we do know is that penetrating trauma patients tend to arrive in hospital quicker. Their scene times are less than blunt trauma patients. And that in those patients who received cryo earlier, there tended to be more patients who'd received penetrating trauma. Now, putting those two things together, it may be that the penetrating trauma patients arrive at hospital sooner, they've had less chance to develop hypofibrinogenemia, and therefore actually are those patients who are not going to benefit from early fibrinogen replacement because they haven't actually got the deficit that we're expecting to correct. Now, on the other end of the U-shaped curve around mortality and time is that these patients were probably not bleeding so much, maybe their fibrinogen levels were not such a problem, and therefore any intervention wasn't going to demonstrate the difference. So it's that sweet spot. There are important limitations, and we have to be careful about drawing too much from these subgroup analyses, but trying to provide some rationale for why we have seen the neutral result, but actually differences in this subgroup, is sort of the thought process that we have at the moment.
At this point, what's your main take home from this very large randomized trial, Nikki?
So the main outcome from this study showed that giving cryoprecipitate to patients on an empiric basis, i.e. for patients who were actively bleeding, who we hadn't done any tests for, is not going to provide benefit to them.
And so then, Ross, does that mean we need a new trial that enriches these populations? Or should we just put the cryoprecipitate on the shelf and only use it if we've measured a fibrinogen first?
What's very interesting for me now, having a little bit of time to digest what this means, is this is probably much more important than if this was a positive trial, because I think this tells us a lot about the limitations for empiric care in trauma resuscitation. The field has moved on tremendously in the last 15, 20 years. We don't give crystalloids, we give much more plasma-based balanced resuscitation. But there is a limit to what that baseline improvement is able to bring to bear. And these additional things that we're talking about giving, whether or not it's prothrombin complex concentrate, fibrinogen replacement, is that these are not necessarily innocuous things. We should give a targeted thing. We need to measure them quickly, and we need to give the right dose at the right time. Those are important questions that we don't actually know the answer to yet.
Thanks, Ross. Let's leave it at that. I think the answer here from this neutral trial is that we still have a lot of questions, and that trauma-induced coagulopathy is incredibly complex. And so we'll wrap up. Thanks for joining us on this JAMA Clinical Review podcast. This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thanks for listening.